feel like every time you hear Veronica sing, you're like in the audience at The Voice, you know? Just waiting for Blake Shelton to turn around and go like that. I love hearing Veronica sing. And boy, it's great to be here and to see all of you here and Disciple Now. I know you guys have had a great weekend. I got to tell you, though, I'm a little bit nervous standing here, primarily because of the junior girls right in front of me. And it's not so much that they make me nervous as far as preaching's concerned, but y'all need to know I have a spitting problem. Like, when I say my T's and stuff, it's like you've sat on the front row at the Shamu show at SeaWorld. So, I mean, I'll stand in front of Lake through the entire thing. So, Marley, I'm sorry if I'm misgone. But it's great to see all of them here. And, man, as Neil said, what a blessing to be a part of a church that really does value teenagers so much. And we do. But for all of you who are here this morning, I want you to take your Bible and turn to Luke chapter 5, if you will. Luke chapter 5. And as you're turning there, I want to tell you a story about a guy named George Mueller, who, when he was the age of these teenagers who are sitting here today, now, back in the 1800s in Germany, he wasn't a kind of a kid who was going to be a disciple now. He was a kid who was looking for trouble. He was always, always getting into trouble. He was stealing money from his dad. He would go to hotels, and he would spend a night in a hotel, and he would sneak out before he had to pay. I mean, he was just that kind of a kid, and finally caught up with him. He spent several weeks in jail as a result of the way that he was living his life. But crazy thing, his dad decided that the best thing for him would be to go to a Bible college and study theology. I mean, really, right? But that's what he did. His father believed that it would be good for him to serve in the clergy because that was considered an honorable position and it made a pretty good living. So that was his father's plan for George Mueller's life. The trouble was, he didn't know the Lord. And so as he went to college, he just continued really the way that he had lived when he was a teenager. He was a big drinker and a big gambler, and he was a life of the party kind of a guy, and he was also known as a person who would make fun of Christians. One day, one of his friends invited him to go to an off-campus Bible study, and he went, not because he wanted to learn about the Bible, because he wanted to find more opportunities to, well, pick on Christians about. But when he went, he was really kind of blown away with the sincerity of the believers who had gathered there for that study. And as he heard the Bible taught, man, it just opened his eyes to a completely different world. He continued to come to that Bible study, and eventually George Mueller would repent of his sins, and he would ask Jesus Christ to come into his life and save him and be his Lord. Mueller began to read what was called missionary papers, and he was learning about missionaries and some of the ways that God was working through people around the world, and he decided that he wanted to be a missionary as well. So he told his dad that he wasn't going to, you know, just be a part of the clergy. He wanted to be a missionary, but that wasn't his dad's plan for his life, and his dad was very angry with him, and, well, as a result, George Mueller was on his own as far as paying for college. He didn't know how in the world he's going to be able to do that. He didn't have a job. He didn't have any money. So he did the only thing he could think to do, and really probably the first time he had really ever done this particular thing. But he decided he just asked the Lord. So he knelt down there in his room, and he began to pray and ask God to provide money for him to stay in school. Within an hour, he had a knock on his door, and one of his professors came into his room and offered him a paid tutoring position, just enough for him to stay in school. Mueller would finish college and, well, instead of being a missionary, he would become a pastor, but the right way. He ended up in England, pastoring a really small church, but as he would walk through the streets of his town, he began to notice all of the children who had no father and mother who, well, they were homeless. And then as he began to dig in a little bit deeper on, well, the lives of these children, he come to find out that they were being taken advantage of in the workhouses. So they had nowhere to stay, and they were forced to do this hard labor with little to no pay. So Mueller felt a burden on his heart that God wanted him to open up an orphanage. But how in the world was he going to be able to do that? He wasn't making any money. He didn't have a place to bring children into. He had nothing to provide them, but, well, he went back to doing what he did when he was in college and he bowed before the Lord and he asked God to provide. It wasn't any time, and God provided a place for him to house some children, provided some people who would work for him and take care of those kids, provided food and provided clothing. And, well, George Mueller continued to pray and God continued to provide, and the orphanage began to grow. They never had a lot of money. Things were never easy. In fact, there was one particular time where the orphanage had grown to 300 children. And one of the workers came to George one morning and said, "Sir, we have no food and no drink to give to these kids for breakfast." George Mueller told her, he said, "Gather all the kids up and bring them into the dining hall." And she did just what he told him to do. And George Mueller stood in front of all of those 300 children, knowing that he had nothing to give them to eat or to drink. And he led them in a prayer, thanking God for the food that they were about to receive. Suddenly, there was a knock on the door. George goes and opens the door, and just outside the door was a local baker who told him, he said, "Man, you're never going to believe this, but in the middle of the night, God told me that I needed to get up and I needed to bake bread for the kids in your orphanage. So I've been baking bread all night long, and I'm just here to deliver this to you." About the same time, there was a milkman with his cart, and the wheel fell off right in front of the orphanage. And so the milkman comes up to George Mueller and he says, "Listen, it's going to take too long for me to be able to fix this cart and make all of those deliveries. This milk is going to spoil. I want to give it to the orphanage." And so that day, after George Mueller had prayed and thanked God for the food that the kids would eat, they had enough bread and milk for 300 children to be fed. This would be George Mueller's life. He would write down in a journal the prayer requests that he brought to the Lord and how God would answer those prayers. And people have looked back at those journals and it's said that there are upwards of 50,000 specific prayer requests that George Mueller saw the Lord answer. 30,000 of those were answered within an hour or at least within the day in which they were prayed. Little did George Mueller know that that day that he bowed down in his dorm room and he asked God to provide for him enough money to stay in school, that that would be what the rest of his life would be like, and that God would come through and deliver for George Mueller time and time again on an exponential scale as thousands and thousands of children would come through that orphanage. Today, as we turn to Luke chapter 5, we're continuing our series on Peter, a life restored. Last week, we saw where at this point in his life, he went by the name Simon. But Simon was introduced to Jesus by his brother Andrew. And if you remember, as Jesus gazed at Simon, he said to him, "You are Simon, son of John, but from now on, you shall be called Peter." And what Peter means is rock. And so what Jesus was telling Simon that day was, "Well, this is who you are right now, but I have an incredible plan for you. My destiny for you is for you to be a rock, one who would stand strong regardless of what was happening in the world and regardless of what difficulty or persecution would come, but one who would stand as a rock for the kingdom of God through whom many people would come to faith in Christ." But there was a lot of restoration work to be done in Simon's life because he wasn't at all a rock when he met Jesus the first time. But today, as we turn to Luke chapter 5, we are going to see the restoration process begin in this man named Simon and how God is going to do something kind of small in his life as we look at today that will affect his life forever. Let's look. Luke chapter 5. "So it was, as the multitude pressed about him," and that "him" is a reference to Jesus, "to hear the word of God, that he stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two boats standing by the lake. But the fishermen had gone from them and were washing their nets. Then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's, and asked him to put out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the multitudes from the boat. So Jesus is doing what he had been doing, and that is he's teaching about the kingdom of God. But the people, as they hear Jesus teach, they recognize that he teaches with a different authority than the scribes do. They've never heard anybody teach like he teaches. And as the crowd is pressing in on him, Jesus realizes he needs to have a little bit of separation between him and the crowd. And so he looks over and he sees two boats. He recognizes that one of them belongs to Simon. So he gets into that boat and he asks Simon to push him off a little bit from the land. And so there Jesus is sitting in this boat with all of these people on the shore, and he's just teaching them. If you think about it, he's kind of doing his own kind of fishing, isn't he? I mean, there he is sitting in a fisherman's boat, just like a fisherman would do. But instead of casting out a normal fisherman's net, what he's casting out is the Word of God. And his kind of fishing is different, not just because he's fishing for men instead of for fish, but, you know, fishermen like Simon and Andrew, well, they would fish to catch these fish for them to die and be sold and consumed. But that's not the kind of fishing Jesus does. As he's fishing for men, he's not fishing for them to be consumed. He's fishing for them in order to set them free. In fact, I want to show you a little bit of Jesus, well, his agenda. So if you'll look back at Luke chapter 4, that may be one page in front of you. It might be on the same page you're looking at. But I want you to look with me at chapter 4 of Luke's gospel, verse 16. Let me show you something here. It says about Jesus that he came to Nazareth where he'd been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and he stood up to read, and he was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah, and when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." Then he closed the book and he gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of all who were in the synagogue were fixed on him. And he began to say to them, "Today the scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." Man, you could have heard a pin drop in that synagogue, because everybody in that room knew what just happened. Jesus had read a passage from Isaiah 61, which was a prophecy about the ministry of the Messiah. And as Jesus reads that and he hands that scroll back over to the scribes, he goes, "The one that's being talked about in this passage, it's me." But I want you to look again at what he says there. In verse 18, at the ending, it says, "To proclaim liberty to the captives." So what kind of captives? Recovery of sight to the blind. What kind of blindness? To set at liberty those who are oppressed. Oppressed from what? You see, what Jesus is talking about is people who are not in the kingdom of God, people who do not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Their eyes have been blinded from the truth of God and his kingdom by Satan. You see, Satan doesn't want you to see God. Satan doesn't want you to know the glory of God. Satan doesn't want you to know God's love for you. He wants to blind you from all of those things. And he doesn't do it by striking you with a physical blindness. No, it's much more subtle than that. It's things like making you so busy you don't have time to think about who God is. Or trying to find meaning and purpose in life through money or career or relationships, and spending your life in your work, or trying to have all of the stuff with the hope that life is going to be better, because if you just give yourself to all of those things, it takes your mind off God. And so the enemy blinds us from the truth of who God is. And you know that blindness is kind of a captivity as well. Because you're just caught in that and you can't get out of it. And even you may even sense that there's got to be more than life than I'm experiencing. And so you're trying all of these different things to try to find that meaning, but you can't. Just kind of held captive by that sin. And my goodness, it's oppressive, because it keeps you from knowing the incredible glory and grace and love of Jesus Christ. So back in Luke chapter 5, as Jesus is fishing for men, he is sitting in that boat and he is casting out the net of the Word of God. He is proclaiming that God loves them. He's proclaiming them what the kingdom is like. He is proclaiming to them that release and the ability to see and no longer being captive or oppressed is available to them through him. So he is fishing for them to catch them and to release them from the captivity that they've been held under for so long. But look at verse 4. It says, when he stopped speaking, he said to Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch. But Simon answered and said to him, Master, we've toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net. So after Jesus gets through teaching, he looks to Simon and he says, Simon, let's go fishing. Now, you remember that Luke tells us that Simon and his brother Andrew and the other fishermen were washing their nets. The fish that they were looking for were fish that you would catch at night. This was daytime. So they'd fished all night long. They have washed out their nets. The last thing in the world they want to do is get back in that boat and go fishing again. And besides, and we see this in Simon's response, he was a pro, man. Simon fished for a living. And the Lake of Gennesaret, that was his house, you know? Nobody knew that lake better than he did. And so Simon says to Jesus, listen, I mean, you're a great teacher and all, and I don't have the amount of people following me that you got following you, but I'm telling you, this is my house. I know this lake. I've been out there. I'm telling you, the fish aren't biting today. This is an absolute waste of time. Well, you know what? Jesus knew they'd been out all night. And Jesus knew that's exactly how Simon was going to respond. But Simon would give him credit. He was a respectful fella. So he says to Jesus, well, you know, if you just want to go, then we'll go. And look at what happens. Verse 6. When they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their net was breaking. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both the boats so that they began to sink. Oh, you know who's smiling in the boat, don't you? That's Jesus. And so Simon, not wanting to go out on the boat, because remember, he was the pro. That was his house. He didn't want to be, he knew it was a waste of time to go out there. But when Jesus was in the boat, man, all of a sudden, things changed. And some question, actually, whether or not that's a miracle or whether just Jesus knew where the fish were. Either way, the difference was Jesus was in the boat and, well, Simon was able to see the difference of having him around. But I want you to see what happens next. Verse 8, when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. I want you to really look at that, because he's not just acknowledging his sin, but notice he is asking Jesus to get out of the boat and leave him alone. Why would he do that? Because I think he's overwhelmed. Possibly for the first time in his life, Simon realizes he doesn't have as much figured out as he thought he did. Remember, he thought he knew everything about fishing. And he thought he knew everything there was to know about that lake. That was his house. But now he's faced with the reality that he doesn't know as much as he thought he did. You see, there's something about seeing God for yourself that helps you to realize you hadn't got it all together as much as you thought you did. And Simon, overwhelmed and humbled, is asking for Jesus in his mercy to just leave him alone. But you know what? Jesus' smile is getting even bigger because he finally has Simon right where he wants him, realizing he needs help. Look what happens in verse 9. For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish which they had taken. And so also were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will catch men." You see, now Jesus, well, he offers him an even bigger launch. You know, one thing that businesses, oftentimes particularly restaurants, do is they do a thing called a soft launch. And a soft launch is kind of when they open up their store or their restaurant before the grand opening. Chick-fil-A did that when they opened up, and our family was invited. It's, well, it's for us, it's considered one of the greatest days of our lives. It cost us absolutely nothing, you know. And we sat down, and I'm telling you, they were bringing us chicken sandwiches and chicken minis and chicken wraps and chicken soup and chicken Dr. Pepper. I mean, everything they brought, chicken everything. We were clucking when we walked out of that place. Greatest day ever. But the reason that they did that is, for one, is because they wanted us to eat the chicken and like the chicken and tell you how great the chicken is. And, well, I guess I just kind of did that today, right? So it worked. But another reason that they do a soft launch is it's an opportunity to learn stuff. Kind of work the kinks out. You know, the managers have to learn how to manage, and, well, the cooks have to learn how to cook, and the checkers got to learn how to check, and the busers got to learn how to bus. I mean, how else do you do that unless you do a soft launch? But all that's to prepare for the big launch. You see, you can kind of look at this fishing expedition that Jesus took Simon on as, well, kind of a soft launch in a way. There are a lot of things that Simon learned that would serve him well later on, but here comes the big launch. Jesus says to Simon, "Simon, I have a different plan for you. I want you to be a fisher of men." Think about it, though. He showed him what that looked like, right? Because he was fishing for men right there in Simon's boat. And he also showed him that he had all the power in the world behind him if he would just follow him, because, my goodness, I mean, Peter's already seen that when Jesus is in the boat, my goodness, it makes a difference in what you can do. Question is, what would Simon do? We see in the next verse. "So when they had brought their boats to land, they forsook all and followed him." So Simon essentially says, "Yes, Lord, I'm ready to go." Now, I want you to think what forsaken all would have looked like for Simon. Remember, he was a fisherman. So fish, that means money. That guy just had the greatest catch of fish he had ever had in his entire life. That was going to bring in more money than he had ever seen at one time, and he left it on the shore. You know what that means? That means that Simon was definitely saying, "Money is not the most important thing to me anymore." Fishermen, or being a fisherman, was all he ever knew. He actually inherited his business from his father, so he grew up as a kid wanting to be a fisherman. But when he left all that stuff right there on that shore to follow Jesus, when it says he forsook all, what it means is he left his life plan right there on the shore to follow Jesus. Being a fisherman, that was his comfort, that was his security, that was his deal, that was his house. And now he's going to follow Jesus as a fisher of men, not even really knowing what that means, and certainly not knowing what all was going to face him in the days ahead, but he left behind his comfort and security, what left behind his house. You know, another thing about fishing's kind of a deal where if you just try at it long enough and work hard enough, you can have success. You're not going to have it every day, but you can just get right back at it. And, well, the more you fish, the more success you're going to have. There's some self-sufficiency in earning a living that way. Fishing for men? We don't have any power to do that on our own. You don't just work harder to fish for men. So he leaves that self-sufficiency behind as well. And he followed Jesus. But at this point in his life, having been through the soft launch and learning that he needed help, that he didn't know all that he thought he knew, and seeing the difference that Jesus can make in his life when he's in the boat with them, Simon's ready for the big launch. He would leave that wooden boat behind, and the boats that he would fish out of in the days ahead would be things like temples and courts in the presence of kings. And even from time to time, the boat he would fish out of would be a prison cell. But oh, what a life he would live. I want to wrap up this morning by giving you several points that you can write down, and I really want you to kind of ponder over them, not just today, but maybe even for the week ahead. Here's the first thing that I want you to ponder. If a little bit of faith is all you have to give, then give him what you got. Now, when you think about it, with Peter's life, when Jesus told him to launch out into the water and go fishing with him, that wasn't just a great example of faith, was it? Peter didn't want to do it. He thought it was an absolute waste of time to do it. But he did it anyway, and look at what happened. You see, the reason I want you to ponder this point is because a lot of times we have a tendency to hold off from launching out with Jesus because we're just not sure. We have our doubts. We have lots of questions. And so we kind of just say, well, listen, I'm a teenager, and there are a lot of things I don't know about God yet, so I'll give my life to God later on when I have things figured out more than I have right now. Listen, the whole point of a weekend called Disciple Now, think about what the word means, disciple now. The whole point of that is for teenagers to understand that you don't have to wait to become an adult to be a disciple of Jesus. You can be a disciple now, right where you are. And for us as adults, you can't sit around waiting to have all of the questions about God answered before you give your life to him. Because here's a newsflash to you. This side of heaven, you're never going to have all those questions answered. So if a little bit of faith is all you got to give him today, give him that. Watch what he does. Second thing I want you to ponder. Listen, if you just launch out on your own in life, you will never know what could have been. Think about now Peter again in that boat. Remember, that's his boat, that's his business, that's his livelihood, and they're fishing in his lake. That's his house. What if Peter would have said, Jesus, listen, I appreciate it, but hey, man, you preach, I fish. You do what you do, I do what I do, all right? Let me do my thing. I'll get back at it tomorrow night and we'll be fine. I don't need to go fishing with you now. You stay back. You see what he would have missed out on? I'm going to be honest with you. I think as a preacher, sometimes you have a tendency to overstate things, and I don't ever want to do that. And I never want to mislead you. So listen to me carefully. I'm going to share with you something that you might be surprised for me to tell you, but I'm going to tell you. If your goal in life is to be wealthy, you can do that without Jesus. If your goal in life is to be famous, to be well known, for people to talk about how great you are in your profession, you don't need Jesus to do that. You can do that without him. If your goal in life is to have a house with a white picket fence and 2.3 kids and a dog and that kind of deal, you can make that happen. But here's what you'll never have: true peace. You can never know true peace in life until you've made peace with God. You can have all of the treasures this world affords, but remember, this is a broken world, and it will never completely satisfy you. If you live life on your own, you can be successful in the things of this world, but you'll never know what true living is like. Third thing I want you to ponder, and that is that if you truly encounter Jesus, then you will see the real you. You see, for a lot of us, we're church folks, maybe even church members, maybe even been baptized, but we've never really seen Jesus. We've been around Jesus, but we've never really seen him. And that's evident, really, kind of by the way we live our lives, and, well, by the fact that we don't quite yet understand how much we really need him, so we do a lot on our own. But you see with Peter, when you see him, things change. By the way, it's not the only person that happened to in the Bible. In the Old Testament, there was a guy named Isaiah. And the scripture tells us that Isaiah went to the temple and he saw God for himself. And boy, the angels surrounding him and crying out, "Holy, holy, holy." And look at what Isaiah says. He says, "Woe is me, for I am undone, because I'm a man of unclean lips and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips." When Isaiah saw God for himself, he saw the truth about himself. You see, what you and I do is generally we compare ourselves with other people. And we can make ourselves feel like we're doing okay because we see a lot of people who are doing worse than us. But we're not to compare ourselves with other people. How do we look in the presence of a holy God? And until we see ourselves for who we really are, we will never experience all that God desires for us. Can I show you something? Because this is what I love to do. It's just fun to me. But I want you to look back again at the text, and I want to point something out to you. Do you notice how in verse 3, Luke's reference to Simon Peter is only by the name Simon? Look at verse 4. Only by the name Simon. Look at verse 5. Only by the name Simon. And this is when Simon is doubting God. This is when Simon is thinking it's a waste of time. Jesus, I know better than you. But look at verse 8 and notice how Luke refers to him. The double name there, right? Simon Peter. What's Luke telling us there? That it's at that moment when he sees himself for who he really is. This is the first time he is beginning to act like the rock God had destined him to be. Final, next to last point. If you hear Jesus calling you to launch out with him today, then forsake everything and follow him. Notice I say if you hear, because there's no doubt he's calling you to launch out with him. That's a no-brainer, that's for sure. The question is whether or not your eyes have been blinded, whether or not you are still held captive and so you cannot hear. But if you hear him call you to launch out today, forsake everything and follow him, what does that look like for you? That means you forsake all that you care about what everybody else says about you. That means you forsake your definition of success and you trade it in for his. That means you forsake your life plan. That means in some regards it may be forsaking a boyfriend or a girlfriend to follow Jesus. Listen, I want you to know, I want every person to know, that if you're a believer, God has called you to be a fisher of men. Did you know that? That's not just reserved for missionaries or for pastors. God calls every believer to be a fisher of men. That's the purpose of our salvation. So if you are not doing that, then you're not living the purpose for which you were saved, and that's disobedience, that's sin. But I want you to think with me about this. Wherever God has you as a believer right now, that place is your boat where you're supposed to be fishing from. So if you're a student, your school is the boat, and you're called to fish for men there. If you're on a sports team, that team is your boat, and you're called to fish for men there. If you're a business person, that place of business is your boat, and you're called to fish there. Here's the question for you. Are you using the boat that God has placed you in to fish for men? Or are you using it to build your own kingdom? Forsake everything and follow him. And then finally, you'll see if God is faithful today, you can trust that he'll be faithful tomorrow. And that's why Jesus gave Peter that soft launch before the big launch, right? Peter was able to see, my goodness, I don't know everything there is to know about life. I need some help. He was able to see, my word, look at the difference Jesus can make in my life if I'll just follow him. That soft launch prepared for the big launch. Same with George Mueller, right? When he bowed on his knees in that dorm room and asked for God to provide money for tuition, little did he know how God would provide for thousands of orphans through George Mueller if he would just launch out with him. So as we wrap up today, what's God been saying to you? Maybe you're here this morning and you're not a Christian. Do you hear God inviting you to launch out with him? I know you don't have the answers to all the questions. You never will. But it begins today. The longer you walk with Jesus, the more answers you'll learn. But will you begin the journey? Will you launch out and trust in him and follow him today? Or maybe you're here this morning and you're a believer. That boat God's given you to fish out of. You fishing for men, or are you building your own kingdom? Even as a believer, are you trying to live life in your power, or are you living in his? Launch out and see what he can do. Let's pray. Father, we bow before you now and we thank you so much for your word, which is life and truth. Thank you for revealing yourself to us through the text. Father, thank you for inviting us to launch out with you this morning. And I pray, God, that you will grant us the faith to do just that. In your name we pray. Amen.